Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is Bester Slot, and we are back with a brand new episode of Pangaea Today. And today, what are we looking at? Well, something potentially very exciting and a little bit controversial. A dinosaur that is suspected to be the missing link in dinosaur evolution and species divergence. We're also going to talk about some slightly more obscure paleontological terms, and hopefully, by the end of this video, you guys have all learned a little something. In the making of this video, it was quite a tough one to make, I'll be honest. I personally learnt quite a lot of new things that I didn't really know about, or things, terms I hadn't even heard of. So hopefully you guys can learn some stuff as well, that would be awesome. Now before we get started on the dinosaur itself, we do need to cover some basic paleontological stuff. So to understand the importance of this dinosaur, we need to understand how dinosaurs are grouped, how they are split, how they are defined. Dinosaurs are predominantly split between two primary groups, which then contain many other little subgroups. Now these groups are called Saurischia and Ornithischia. I'm going to say those many times in this video, so hopefully I can get the pronunciation correct. It's worth noting that this split is under threat and that modern paleontologists don't necessarily agree with how this is done, but that's a topic for another video. Now the primary difference between these two different groups is found in the hips. Ornithischia literally means bird-hipped, and it means these dinosaurs have a pelvic structure like that of modern birds, whereas Saurischians possessed a completely different structure. The picture I'm going to show you guys now should hopefully demonstrate this difference pretty ably. You can see there's a fairly demonstrable difference between the two different pelvic structures. Now, one of the primary reasons for this difference in hip shape is that typically herbivorous dinosaurs require a larger gut to digest plant material, and the pelvic shape in these Ornithischians allows for that increased gut size. If you think about a modern cow, it's got like 7 stomachs or whatever, that's because the plant material requires that much more effort to digest. So a bigger gut allowed these herbivorous dinosaurs to digest plant material more efficiently. And saying that, it's worth noting that Saurischians are typically carnivorous and Ornithischians are typically herbivorous, but many exceptions do exist in both groups. Therizinosaurus, for example, that huge, awesome, my absolute beloved Therizinosaurus, the danger floof, is a Saurischian despite being herbivorous. Finally, before we get started on the dinosaur itself, it's worth also mentioning a group called Tetanurae. This is a group of theropods, which are in turn a group of Saurischians. I'll hopefully bring up a little diagram for that. Tetanurae contains most theropods and is defined as ones more closely related to modern birds than they are to Ceratosaurus. And this includes dinosaurs like Tyrannosaurus Rex. Tyrannosaurus Rex is a member of Tetanurae. With that out of the way, let's talk about the dinosaur itself. It's called Chilesaurus Diego Suarezi. Chilesaurus because, well, it's from Chile. Whilst Diego Suarez is the name of the 7-year-old boy who stumbled across the first fossil. Now, since that first fossil has been found, they've found full skeletons. It's been quite an amazing find. But this little kid, lucky little kid, found that first fossil, and that's why it's named after him. It's also a herbivorous dinosaur, and it's from the late Jurassic, approximately 145 million years old. It's getting on a little bit. Now, the interesting thing, predominantly, about this little dinosaur is that it's what's being described as a platypus dinosaur. You imagine a platypus, a duck-billed platypus, the little freaky Australian mammal. It's because different part of its body seems completely suited to different creatures, just as in a platypus. This is caused by something known as mosaic or modular evolution, wherein evolutionary change occurs at a different rate depending on the body part or system. If you want another example of this, you can look up a pterosaur called Darwinopterus, which would at times display facets of both pterodactyls and rhamphorhynchids, which would evolve down the line. This little raptor-esque dinosaur is confusing enough that people can't actually decide what group it should be in. Initially, it was placed in the Tetanura group of theropods that we discussed earlier. However, a new paper released just last week has instead suggested it should be an entirely different group, the Ornithischians. They suggested it would be placed here because it's got the flat teeth, suggesting it's a herbivore like most Ornithischians, not all, and it has the bird-like hip, which was again found in some theropods, but very, very few. They were outliers, and generally speaking, reserved for herbivorous Ornithischians. However, despite that, it doesn't have the large beak-like structure found in all other Ornithischians. If you imagine a Triceratops or a Stegosaurus, other examples of Ornithischians, they've got a fairly prominent beak. Now, I know that it looks like it may do on the above picture that you can see now, but in other Ornithischians, the beak is caused by something called a predentary. Now, what a predentary is an extra attached piece of bone on the lower jaw, like right at the front of the lower jaw. And what that was good for was helping dinosaurs, herbivorous dinosaurs, tear plants away before they fed upon them. Chilisaurus does not have this. It is the only ornithischian that I can find that doesn't have a predentary. What this tells us, potentially, if it is in fact an ornithischian, is that in the chain of evolution, the bird-hipped assets of ornithischians was developed before the predentary, and it shows that Chilisaurus is probably a transitional dinosaur that led to the ornithischians we know now. But why was it not placed as an ornithischian? Why did the original paper place it as a tetanurin? Why is there this confusion? Not only is it lacking key features of other ornithischians, such as the beak, but it contains those typically reserved for theropods, including something called a, and you have to bear with me here, a dolicholiac pelvis. And yes, I will try to explain that. A dolicholiac pelvis. On your pelvis, you have a concave surface called the acetabulum. And what this is basically the spot where the femur, i.e. the thigh bone, connects to your pelvis. If you imagine your pelvis, or look at the one on the screen, you can see the concave space, that's where the femur hits, and that's where it connects, and that's what the acetabulum is. Now, in a dolicholiac pelvis, the region behind this surface is larger because it carries more of the weight of the thigh muscles. Basically, dolicholiac dinosaurs have more strength in the back end of their thigh muscles than they do in the front end. There's more mass in the back of their thigh than there is in the front, and it is a trait typically reserved for theropods. Similarly, the stocky arms of the Chilisaurus suggest it's a theropod, as do the pockets of space found in its vertebrae, and these are typically found in theropods as a way of shifting their centre of mass, and what that does is it makes them more agile and therefore increases their hunting prowess. You've got to remember, these are traditionally carnivorous dinosaurs. Just in case Chilisaurus wasn't complicated enough already with its facets from theropods and its facets from ornithischids, it's got a small head and small feet, very emblematic of sauropods, and it's got these large outwards extending claws, which is a feature traditionally found elsewhere in dinosaurs such as Therizinosaurus. Chilisaurus is a mass of different features from several different dinosaur groups, and despite the paper last week suggesting it's an ornithischian, other researchers are still unconvinced. It's likely that this is a debate that will continue on for some time, but regardless of its eventual placing, the chances are it's a basal dinosaur for the group it's placed in, i.e. it's one of the first of its kind. It could be a very, very basal early Teturian, it could be a very, very basal early on ornithischid. Ornithischian, I should say. And this mix of different features that Chilisaurus has, and others like it, if discovered, suggests that this is potentially the point in which saurischians and ornithischians began to diverge from each other into the distinct groups they're considered today. It may represent the missing link for dinosaurs, the transitional dinosaur that connects all the divergent groups of dinosaurs together to their more common ancestors, and it could potentially tell us a lot about how they evolved. Perhaps Chilisaurus started life as a carnivore, and that's why it's got all these theropod features. Then, given the environment or a lack of food, it had to develop herbivorous traits in order to survive. It could be the other way around. Either way, this story is going to keep developing, and hopefully we can reach an eventual classification, and until then, well, we can speculate away. Thank you so much for joining me, folks. This one was probably the hardest one for me to do so far, because there is an absolute lack of digestible information out there. It's not like the last two where it was very, very big news all over the place. This one was a little less talked about, so it's quite hard to get this information together. But hopefully this helped explain why this dinosaur could be so important and why it's so weird. Now, if you did like this video and you want to see more of Pangaea today, please do hit that like button, comment down below letting me know you enjoyed it, and if you hit that subscribe button, you will obviously be kept up to date with all future episodes of Pangaea today. I'm going to quickly address something. People do keep asking me to do things on certain dinosaurs in particular. I am working on a separate series from Pangaea today wherein we will potentially just hone in and discuss and analyze and enjoy talking about a specific creature. I've got a couple in mind already, but that would be called, I don't know, Paleo Profiles or something like that. Pangaea today is about the recent paleontological news. Okay, that's about it. Thank you so much for joining me. Cheers, much love, as always. Bye-bye.